All right, we will start with respect to the synopsis of coordination compounds. Now, the first part what we have is about what we can call, there are two types of what we can call as the stable compounds when we talk with respect to their stoichiometric part. One is what we call as the double salts, and the other one what we call as the coordinated complexes. Now, when I talk about the double salts, that's basically nothing but over there where these molecules will exist, their ions have their own identity. Like, for example, if I talk about potash alum, is this clear? That's nothing but what we call as the alum part, which is potassium sulfate, aluminium sulfate with 24 moles of water. About water molecule, we all know the water molecules can either be hydrogen bonded, or it can be coordinately bonded, or it can be interstitial bonded. So the water molecule remains practically unionized, but potassium sulfate will give potassium ions, sulfate ions, and aluminium sulfate will give aluminium and sulfate ions. So you can individually check their properties. Similarly, carnallite, we have done in P block, that's the ore of chloride. That's potassium chloride, magnesium chloride with 6 water will give potassium chloride and magnesium ions. And more salt, what we also call as FAS, ferrous ammonium sulfate. That will be ferrous, that will be sulfate, as well as it will be ammonium ions over there. 3 ions property is what we will get over there. And again, water, that will remain unionized. Whereas when I'm talking about coordination of complex compounds, now in the coordination part over there, what's going to happen over there? All the ions are not provided by the complex over there. It depends upon the bonds between the metal and the ligand. Sometimes, depending on the stability constant values, they may ionize to a certain extent, or they may not ionize at all. So that way we have the coordinated complexes, where it says in aqueous solutions, these compounds do not furnish all the simple ions, but instead they will give more complex ions like potassium argentocyanide. It will not give you the silver and the cyanide ions, but it will give the argentocyanide ion together over there. Same way K4FeCN6. So whatever is written outside, K4 will give 4 potassium ions plus 1 ferrocyanide ion. Same way copper ammonium sulfate will give cupra ammonium will be 1 ion and sulfate will be the another ion that way. Normally in these complexes, the central metal is generally a transition metal. Transition metal, why? One, last 2 shells are incompletely filled. So that's why electrons can be shared from 2. That's why these compounds, they show variable oxidation states. And second important point, they have high charge by radius ratio. So higher the positive charge, smaller the size. So greater the magnitude of charge by radius ratio. So greater the charge by size ratio, we will say it will have more stability to form complexes over there. Now in these complexes, we have 2 parts. The central metal that behaves as a Lewis acid, and the ones which donate the lone pair, they are the ligands, what we call them as Lewis bases over there. So 2 parts. So Lewis acid is the central metal, which has a tendency to accept the lone pair of electrons coming from the ligand. Ligands are the species which have a tendency to donate the lone pair of electrons. All right, so they are Lewis bases. So these ions over there, that is nothing but Lewis base and Lewis acid part. Then the next we have over there, the types of complexes. Now, depending on the net charge on the complex, we have cationic complex where the complex has a positive charge, like how we call this as hexaamine cobalt Roman number 3 or tetraamine copper Roman number 2. So that's cationic. Anionic complex, that's going to be dicyano or cyanido, any one name. Dicyano, then silver is called argentate. All anionic complex, we end it with 8. So if there's a negative charge outside, then we end with, that's an anionic complex. So we end with, end the name of the metal with the word 8, A-T-E. So it is nothing but dicyanoargentate, Roman number over there 1, because silver is in plus 1 state. Same way FeCN6, 4 minus, hexacyanoferrate, Roman number 2, Fe is in plus 2. And neutral complex, no charge, NiCO4, that's tetracarbonyl nickel, 0. Or CuNH3 thrice Cl3. Now here the Cl3 are inside. So this is basically, we write alphabetically, tri first amine will come because A. So triamine trichlorido cobalt Roman number 3. Then on the basis of stability of the complex in which we say whether it will dissociate or not dissociate. So these are compounds in which the complex is fairly stable and is either not dissociated or very less dissociated. And that goes with, as I said, for metals, the charge by radius ratio, depending upon the ligand, whether it's a strong field or a weak field ligand. So strong field ligand will form over there a low spin complex. So it's difficult for it to break those bonds. That's why they dissociate either less or they are practically unionized or undissociated. Second factor to discuss whether they will dissociate or no will be the stability constant. If the stability constant is greater, then we will say the complex will be more stable, difficult to ionize or dissociate. But if the stability constant is a low value, then it will ionize over there. Like look at that, K4FeCN6, potassium ferrocyanide, it dissociates very feebly to give you ferrous and cyanide ions that way. Imperfect or normal complexes. These are the ones where the complex ion is less stable. Is this clear? And it is reversibly dissociated. Like over there, we'll have potassium over there, tetracyano. Then we have over there nothing but cadmium. That's going to be in plus two state, where the potassium and the cadmium cyanide ions are given out. And the cadmium cyanide ions will further ionize to give cadmium and cyanide ions. The reason, it's a weak complex. The logic for a weak complex is cyanide is a strong field ligand, but the cadmium metal is the one which is a, you know, which will have less tendency to allow the cyanides to donate ligand. So when ionized, it will immediately break down to give cadmium ions and cyanide ions that way. That's the stability constant part, what we'll be seeing in the ahead part. Then the reactivity of complex, we say the complexes are called as labile complexes. Labile, the ones which are highly, what it says, the ones which are highly reactive, they can be easily replaced by other ligands. Then they are called labile complex. Labile generally is where you can, you know, they are the ones, we, you know, so they will be highly reactive by the action of heat or sunlight, either of them. That's the reason why we call such them as highly reactive. Those are the labile complexes. Inert complexes, the reactivity is very less and you cannot replace the ligands over there. That's one. Then intermetallic or inner complexes formed by ligands containing neutral and an anionic coordinating group in the same molecule. So you are having intermetallic or inner complex. So these are complex. Ligands contains a neutral as well as a coordinated part. Where I look at that. Glycine ATO, is this clear? Or we call it as the other one as ACAC, that is acetyl acetonato. Now those are the ones which has got a lone pair also, as well as it has a negative charge also in the same ligand. Glycine ATO, that's basically nothing but what we have as glycine, that part. So from glycine, that's the alpha amino acetic acid. You remove the H, then you are getting glycine ATO ion. And same way we have acetyl acetoester. From that part, we have this molecule that is acetyl acetonato, where it has got over there a negatively charged group as well as a normal oxygen also, which can donate a lone pair. So this is a complex where the ligand has a neutral part as well as an anionic part. That's what the examples are given there. This is glycine ATO with cobalt 3 and acetoacetonato, which is got also with cobalt 3 complex. Then complex ion or coordination entity, electrically charged radical formed by the combination of a simple cation in which one or more neutral molecules or simple anions, in some cases, the positive groups called ligands are there. So complex ions may, you will have the central metal or it can be a cation or it can be an anionic complex or a neutral complex. And the ligands are generally anions or neutral molecules. Very few cases you have the ligands as positively charged. We will see in the classification. Then the central metal, I told you central metal is basically a D block elements. And depending upon how many ligands are coming on the central metal vacant orbitals, we will have the different isomers of it. That is a geometrical and the stereo isomers over there. Then ligands, anionic or neutral. Now they are of different types. Unidentate ligands, dent means a point of attachments. Unidentate, one point of attachment. Fluoride, chloride, bromide, iodide, cyanide, then thiocyanate, NO2 minus, nitrite, ammonia, that's amine, that's water, pyridine, C5H5N, Darzan's method, nitrogen has one lone pair. Then OH hydroxyl, O2 2 minus, O2 minus, PH3, that's phosphine, NO, nitric oxide, carbon monoxide, sulfate, acetate, sulfide, S2O3 2 minus, thiosulfate ion, NO3 minus, nitrate, SO3 2 minus, sulfite, C6H5, the whole thrice P, triphenyl phosphine, then CsNO plus, that's a nitrosonium ion, NO2 plus, nitronium ion, electrophile, NH2 minus, NH minus, thiourea, the compounds what we have. That is NH2, CS, NH2. That's thiourea, where normal urea is NH2, C double bond O NH2. So instead of the double bond O, it is with sulfur. So it's C double bond S and then NH2. Bidentate, that is basically two points of attachment, ethylene diamine, what we have, or we have it also as nothing but bipyridyl. That is basically two pyridine groups, if they are joined together, then that's the one. Normally we have is ethylene diamine, then oxalato, what we have, that is one that's from oxalic acid. Then glycinato, that is from glycine. I'm just taking the main ones. Rest of them, just for your understanding. Same way, carbonate ions over there. But the main important ones in bidentate is oxalate and glycinato ions. That is one. And ethylene diamine. Then the next ones, what we have, that's tridentate, tetradentate ligands over there, where here you can have, like, for example, diethylene, triamine. That's what we have. That's an example over there. That's nothing but diene, one part. Then tetradentate, that's a tridentate ligand. Then again, we have triethylene, tetramine. So look here, the names are clear. Diethylene, triamine. So three points of attachment. Then triethylene, tetramine. Then that's four points of attachment. Then we have also a pentadentate ligand, that's ethylene diamine triacetate ion. So EDTA 3 minus is a pentadentate ligand, just for your information. Most important here is hexadentate. This was asked in the 2021 paper only of the NEET. EDTA 4 minus, that's ethylene diamine tetraacetate ions, which has 6 points of attachment. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 6. Each nitrogen will have one lone pair. So be clear, EDTA 4 minus is hexadentate. EDTA 3 minus is a pentadentate ligand. 5 points of attachments. That's 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. Okay. So important is this hexadentate one, what we have. Then we have ambidentate ligands. Ambidentate is the one which has got more than one electron rich center in the same molecule. Like SCN, thiocyanate ion. You can have attachment from sulfur as well as from N. So you can have SCN and NCS, that is isothiocyanate. Same way NO2. NO2 will have nothing but attachment from N as well as from O. So we just have NO2 group, that's nitrite to N, or ONO, that's nitrite to O. Same way cyanide and isocyanide, CN and NC. So they coordinate through only one atom. At a time, it will be only one point of attachment. But in a molecule, there can be two probabilities of different attachments. Then it says polydentate ligands are said to be flexidentate character if they do not use all its donor atoms to get coordinated. Example, EDTA generally acts as hexadentate, but it can act as pentadentate as well as tetradentate. So depending upon in the molecule, how many vacant orbitals are available till the repulsion is minimized between the central atom and the ligand. Normally EDTA asks, just EDTA asks, it is EDTA raised to 4 minus. So that's an example of hexadentate ligand. Then coordination number, we all know. Coordination number is the bonds formed between the central metal and the ligand over there. Normally coordination numbers we have is 4 and 6, where 6 is mainly going for octahedral geometry, which is D2SP3 or SP3D2. And with coordination number 4, it's mainly the square planar complexes. That is DSP2 hybridized. Or in 4, we have SP3 hybridized also. That is with the metal carbonyl complex, like NiCO4. Then, next we have is the coordination sphere. Now, coordination sphere is basically the square brackets what we write over there. That is the coordination sphere where the metals and the ligands are present. On the left-hand side of the square brackets, what we write is the metal. And on the right-hand side, outside the brackets, we will write is the ions that it will form over there. Okay. So if I'm writing over there, K4FeCN6. So it's the four potassium ions plus the ferrocyanide ion that will be formed. Or if I'm writing over there, CONH36, NH34Cl, and outside, if I'm writing sulfate, outside what is written, that sulfate will be ionized as a sulfate ion along with the one coordinated complex that way. Coordination polyhedron, it depends upon what the complex is. Tetrahedral, that's for sp3. Then we have square central atoms over there, where we can have square planar, where square planar is for dsp2. Octahedral is for d2sp3 or sp3d2. Square pyramidal is for distorted sp3d2. Like if you remember the normal interhalogen compounds in chemical bonding, as per VACPR, what we have done, BRFI, bromine pentafluoride, was also square pyramidal structure. Four bromine at the corners of the plane and one bromine at the top of the pyramid and one lone pair down. Then trigonal bipyramidal, that's basically your sp3 dehybridized, or you have dsp3 hybridized. Then oxidation state is basically the charge on the central metal what we have. So to calculate the charge is very simple. Ene, like ethylene diamine, is a neutral ligand, so no charge. You have Cl over there, which has a charge of -1. ONO, that's nothing but nitrito O, will have a charge of -1. So cobalt, to make it neutral, the charge will be +2 that way. Then we have homoleptics and heteroleptic ligands or complexes. Sorry, homoleptics, matlab all the ligands will be of one type only, like this. Hexaamine cobalt, Roman number 3. All ligands of same types. And heteroleptics, you will have apart from, means you can have more than one type of ligand in the coordination sphere. So like, look at that. So this will be dichloro tetraamine cobalt 3 over there, that way. Then ionization sphere or the counter ions. Look at that. Outside the square bracket is the ionization sphere. Now the sulfate is outside. So this will ionize to give you two particles. CuNH342+, that's a cupraammonium ion, and it will give you a sulfate ion. Then we have denticity of the ligand. What is denticity? Number of donor atoms of the ligating group from a given ligand to the same central atom is called the density. Matlab, how many point charges are there? Matlab, how many atoms are there that's going to donate the lone pair of electrons? That's the denticity, what we have. Charge on the complex. Now, normally the charge can be positive, it can be negative, or it can be a neutral complex also, that way. So that is one category. Now we have the different examples to talk. One, we have chelating ligands. Chelating ligands comes from the word chel. Chel means crab's claw. Okay. So those which will try to trap the metal atoms in the form of a ring structure and form a crab's claw, that's called a chelating ligand. So what it says, multi-dentate ligand simultaneously coordinates with a metal through more than one sigma electron pair. On the donor side, a ring-like structure is obtained. This is called a chelate, crab's claw. And the ligand is called a chelating ligand, and the process is called chelation. Now, the chelate effect is what over there? The stability of the complex is more. The stability is greater, increased by chelation, because it traps the metal ion carefully. So more the number of rings present, the we say the stability will be more of the complex. Like look at that, CuEn2+. That's nothing but bis in a bracket, ethane 1,2-diamine, copper, Roman number 2. That's less stable than FeEDTA-. The reason, more number of rings. This copper will have only 2 rings with ethylene diamine. This has got 5 rings. Now, this is just for your understanding. Look at that. You are having 2 rings on one side. Is this clear how the complex part is there? So the 2 rings, basically the whole part is there. So this is one ring and that's the second ring, what it forms. And here it says in this complex, it has got 5 different rings in different forms. So 1, 2, 3, 4. So with each one, you can call the group as one of them. So look at that. This can be taken as 1. This can be taken as 1, 2. Then this can be taken as 1. That will be 3. Then this is the fourth one, what it forms. And that's the fifth one, what it has. So 5 different points of attachment, what comes over there. That forms. So more the number of chelating groups, more stable is the complex. That's one part. Then characteristics. Chelates are most stable over there. This is because when chelation occurs, entropy increases and the process becomes more favorable. What is entropy? Randomness. If the randomness of the system will increase, then we say the process is going to be more spontaneous. It will happen on its own over there. That's why it says more the chelating ligands, greater the entropy. Chelates having 5 members are most stable if the chelating ligands which form them do not contain double bonds, because in double bonds you'll have pi. If the chelating ligands are saturated, ethylene, diamine. On the other hand, chelating having 6 members are most stable if they contain conjugated double bonds. I hope everybody remembers conjugated double bonds. Conjugated is alternate arrangement of single and double bonds, like the acetyl acetonato, that is ACAC, what we call as the ligand. It's an extra part, but just for your info. This part is totally extra, but just for your information over there. Okay, entropy will increase if the complex has got more chelating ligands. Then, chelate formed with chelating ligands have more than 6 donors or larger groups are generally unstable, is this clear, than those formed having smaller groups. That's because of the steric hindrance, because more the number of ligands coming in, it will lead to electron-electron and nucleus-nucleus repulsion. That's the steric hindrance part. Then importance of chelates, one is in softening of hard water, that is EDTA what is used, separation of lanthanides and actinides, because lanthanides and actinides have similar properties for their separation. Detection of metal ions in the qualitative analysis, that is your cation analysis. An estimation of nickel, magnesium, and cupric ions. Nickel ions with DMG, that is dimethyl glyoxine over there. Same way you can also use for estimation of magnesium and cupric ions. Homonuclear and polynuclear complexes. Metal atom is present in which only one metal atom is present. That's a homonuclear complex. On the other hand, which has more than one metal, then that's called a polynuclear complex. Now the nomenclature rules over there, the naming part over there, how we have this part, we have seen this part. So this will be alphabetically, ammonia is called as amine. So here we write the name as hexaamine cobalt 3 chloride. We don't say the word trichloride because Cl3, Cl is one only, but 3 chloride ions. So cobalt 3 oxidation state, plus 3 state is because the Cl3 is outside. So it's -1 × 3 - 3. So the cobalt is +3. Same way for this name, when they are together inside, then we go alphabetically. So here diamine, over there nothing but tetrachloro or tetrachlorido. Diamine, tetrachlorido, platinum 4. Now, negatively charged ligands over there, which ends in O over there, that is glycine, glycinato, cyanido or cyano, NO2 minus is nitro, hydroxo, O2 minus is oxo, O2 2 minus, that's a peroxide group, so it's peroxo, and HO2 2 minus is per hydroxo, that is OOH group, what we call. That's nothing but a, if anybody remembers, cumene hydroperoxide, what we did in the preparation of phenols, that's the per hydroxo group. If the name of the anionic ligand ends with ide, IT or 8, the last E is replaced by O, giving ido, ito, or ato, depending upon how it is. So chlorido, sulfato, oxalato, ONO is nitrito O, NO3 is nitrato, acetato, acetic acid, acetate ions, NH2 minus is amido, NH2 minus is imido, N3 minus is nitride, sulfido or thio, carbonato, thiocyanato S, NCS, isothiocyanato N. Do specify, because these are the embedded groups. H minus hydride ion, so that's called the hydrido. N3 minus, that's the azide group, so azido, iodido, bromido, fluorido. Sulfide is called sulfito, and thiosulfate is thiosulfato ions. That's one. Okay, that's what it says. The names chloro, bromo, iodo, fluoro, cyano are still used. So depending upon the MCQ, you need to check. If an option comes where it is chloro and chlorido, go with chlorido. If they give an option of chloro, chlorido and say both A and B, then fine, you can go with both. But if you select between chloro and chlorido, go with chlorido. That's as per the NCERT. Neutral ligands over there. It's amine, so double M. Water is aqua or aquo, use aqua. NO is nitroso, carbonyl, thiocarbonyl, dioxygen or dinitrogen. Then, positively charged ligands, some of them that ends with the word IM. Like, look at that. N2H5+, that's from hydrazine. So NH2, NH2 is hydrazine. You add a proton, it becomes hydrazinium ion. NO plus, nitrosonium ion. It's a nitroso group. So add IM there. So nitrosonium. NO2 plus, nitronium. Then from pyridine, pyridinium. Or C6H5, 4 times P+, that's tetraphenyl phosphonium ion. Then organic ligands, free or neutral molecules. That can be methyl, ethyl, cyclopentadienyl, then phenyl, pyridine, thiourea, triphenyl phosphine. All these are the organic ligands, where the central atom will have lone pair, or they will have basically nothing but the pi electrons to give. Complicated ligands represented ene for ethylene diamine and py for pyridine. Ambidentate ligand, the point of attachment, we have seen this part, whereas look at that. If you have MNO2, that's nitrito N, point of attachment between M and N is through nitrogen. And here the point of attachment is through O, so it's nitrito O. This is for ambidentate ligand. Then, if in the name only we have di, tri, then in this course, for those ligands, we use the word bis, tris, and tetrakis, like ethylene diamine. Then we have bis, tris, tetrakis are used in those cases. All right. For 4-ammonia, we will just say the word tetramine. Preference order, all ligands, whether they are named alphabetically. Now, naming of the complex ion, write the metal first if it is outside. Then the ligands in the alphabetical order. Then the central atom, which is in the complex, that is in the coordination sphere, followed by the anion outside, and put the Roman number for the metal, which is inside. So the Roman number is in the brackets. Like, look at this part. Here, there is nothing outside on the left. So start with the ligand, amine alphabetically. So tetraamine, copper, 2-sulfate. Okay, that's one part. If the complex is an anion, then you end it with 8. All right. So the metals, titanium is titanate, vanadate, chromate, manganate, ferrate, cobaltate, nickelate, cuprate, zincate, argentate, platinum, aurate. Tantalum is tantalate, zirconium, zirconate, molybdate, tungstate, palladate, gallate, germanate, thalate, bismuthate, borate, silicate, plumbate, stannate, iridate. OS is osmium, so it's osmate. If the complex compound is an acid where the cation is H+, and the name of the metal is written to the end, INIC, followed by the oxidation state. Whereas look at that, H4PtCN6. If you have hydrogen outside, then it's basically, it's an acid, it's going to give H+. So the end part has to be, so it's hexacyanoplatinic acid. That's how we write it with respect to hydrogen outside. A number of geometrical isomers, square planar, that's mainly for dsp2, octahedral, that's for sp3d2 or d2sp3, where you can have similar atoms on the same side. So 1-4 if you take on one side, or you take 2-3, then that's basically the cis isopar, and the trans part will be in the opposite, which will be 1-3. Or it will be 2-4. square planar, that is one. Octahedral complex, if I have to put it up over there, cis on the same side of the triangular face. So 1, 2 on the same face. Similarly, 1, 3 also on the same face over there. As well as we can have 1, 4 also on this side. So 1, 4 can be there, as well as we can have over there as 1, 5 on the same part. Sorry. 1, 5 is also there, as well as we can have 2, 3, as well as 4, 5. That all will be cis, and trans will be the opposite sides one that we have. So with respect to the trans, if I have to put up, then we have the positions 1 and 6, 3 and 5, and 2 and 4. That will be the trans ones. Okay. Then naming of the optical isomers. Optical isomers will be dextro and levo. What we have to do, this is mainly with respect to the polydentate ligands over there, what we have. So plus is for dextro and minus is for levo. Like this compound, we can have plus or D, K3CrC2O43-. Is this clear? That's basically potassium trioxalato. Over there, nothing but chromate. Because it's an anionic complex, it will be. So potassium trioxalato chromate. Over there, nothing but Roman number 3. That is the part. Now, naming of the bridge ligands. Now, this is very important. Bridging ligands, it's an extra part, but I'll be putting it clear. But in case sometimes they are asking you, you should be in a position over there. Look at that carefully. If you have like this NH and OH, then how do we name them in the complex? So look at that first. Bisethylene diamine, that is for this two. Cobalt 3. Now what you do is oxidation state. You can just do it directly there, because NH is going to be -1. OH is going to be -1. And outside the charge, what you see, is this clear, is of 3+. So if it is going to be 3+ over there, then these two cobalt have to be in over there, nothing but +3+3. Okay. So we can have, we just now saw the charges. If anybody saw it carefully, we just spoke about the charges over there. So if I'm talking about NH, your NH charge is 2-, OH is -1. Okay, 2-, 1-, over there. So we can have over there, outside is 3-, so both the cobalt are in +3. All right, that's one part. So that's why bisethylene diamine, cobalt 3. Now what is bridge? You put the symbol nu. Nu hydroxo, nu imido, and again bis for the other one. Now bis ethylene diamine cobalt 3 ion, or if you want, you can write the whole thing together, 4-ene groups. So tetrakis in a bracket ethylene diamine mu hydroxo, alphabetically mu imido, and then dicobalt, because there are two cobalt ions both in +3. So if the bridge is there, use the term nu there. Okay. OH is -1 and NH is 2-, because from ammonia, if you remove 2H, it will be NH2-. That's the imido group. Name of the complex having metal-metal bonding. Now for the metal-metal bonding over there, we know what it says. The prefix bi is used with the name of the metal atoms. For example, symmetrical platinum-platinum bond. Look at that. Symmetrical. If two metals are there and you have two identical ligands attached to it. So it says sim means symmetrical. Dichlorido. Is this clear? That's the part, because two chlorine atoms. Dichlorido. Octakis. Because 8 atoms over there, points of attachments. Okay. Methylamine. And then biplatinum. So that's what it says. Use the word bi there. Platinum 2 chloride. Because what's outside, that's methylamines over there. They are not going to have over there nothing but any type of what we can call as methylamine will have only one point of attachments. That is through the nitrogen atom over there. That's one. So no charge on that. So the each Cl is going to be over there nothing but what we can have as -1, -1. And the 2 Cl outside is -1 × 2. So total negative charge is -4. So each platinum has to be in class 2. That's right. Okay. Then structure, what it says, common names in place of IUPAC are also used when you have ZN O2 2 minus. They are more convenient than the IUPAC. Like FeCN6 4 minus is a ferricyanide ion. FeCN6 ferricyanide for ferrocyanide for FeCN6 4 minus, because ferrous. Ferricyanide for FeCN6 3 minus, ferric plus 3. That way. Same way, cobalt nitrite, or what we call it as, you know, over here, we call this as nitrito O or nitroprusside ion, because those are the ions which are common. So the ones which are very commonly used, you can use these names also. Then the whole list is there of the IUPAC complexes to refer over there. What you can see the names part over there. Then writing the rules with respect to the mononuclear part, alphabetical order and all that part is all fine. I don't think that's important. Because those are the ones which you people already know about it. Take a look at that. This compound, to balance it, the formula part will be tetraamine, so four ammonia groups, tetraamine, aqua, matlab one water, chlorido, matlab one Cl. Then this is all in the coordination sphere. So then it's cobalt. And now look at the charge, ammonia neutral, water neutral, HCl is minus one, Cl2 is outside because it says cobalt 3 chloride. So it's cobalt 3 chloride. Then in that case, you will have this as one Cl minus one, other two Cl is minus one into two. So the cobalt will be in plus three state. Then in platinum complexes, six coordinated are generally tetravalent and four coordinated is divalent. So with respect to four coordinated platinum, keep in mind, is generally is divalent, and the six coordinated one, it is tetravalent. The other first platinum is divalent and second is tetravalent. Okay. So you have to remember this part. So with respect to coordination number four, this platinum is in plus two, and with coordination number six, platinum will be always in plus four. That's the part. Then the next one we have, that is potassium hexanitro. That's nitrito N. Cobaltate 3, that's called Fischer's salt. That's one. These are some of the ones where they have the special names. The common name is potassium cobalt nitrite. Then the brown ring test, this is very important, where Fe is in plus one oxidation state. That is Fe H2O5 NO raised to 2 plus, in which ion has a formal charge of plus one oxidation state. That's one. So due to charge transfer transition, I have discussed with you, what is charge transfer? Transfer of electron from ligand to the metal over there, that way. So here the NO is transferring the electron over there. That's why the color is there, which is a brown complex what it has. And that's why the name of this is penta aqua nitrosonium ion 1. That is the part where the hybridized state of Fe is sp3d2 and it is paramagnetic. So remember about this complex, anytime if they're asking you, here Fe is in plus one state, NO ka state is plus, NO ka charge is plus one, and Fe is sp3d2 and it's paramagnetic. Coming to the isomerism parts, what we have, so we have the different isomers. First, the stereo or space isomers, where in that category we have over there nothing but first part, that is a geometrical cis trans isomerism, similar atoms on the same side or on opposite side. Same side is cis, opposite is trans. And then we will have also one more category, that is a dextro and levo part. This is mainly possible where the coordination number is of 4 and 6, that is square planar and octahedral quantities over there. Now with coordination number 2, 3, 4, generally this type of isomerism of cis trans is not seen. That is one. Isomerism in complex with coordination number 4. Look at that, square planar complex. That's going to be mainly because of dsp2 hybridized, where look at that. If you have 2Cl on the same side, that is cis, 2Cl on the opposite side, that is trans. But if you have Cl and Br, that is two halogen atoms showing identical properties, then we can have two cis and one trans. That's how it goes. So that's the common example. So that is the part, look at that. If you have two separate, like for example, the halogen atoms as X and Y over there, then the probability is there. We can have X, Y, and with different positions. So we can have two cis and we can have one trans over there. But the X and Y can be the halide atoms, like the chloride and bromide parts. That is one category. Okay. Then the next we have is with respect to, now this is the cis and the trans forms. What we see, cis basically same side. That is, if you see the groups over there, NH2, CH2, both on the same side, and now these two on the opposite sides, and that's going to be trans over there. That is one part. Now, square planar of these types, MA4, MA3X, MAX3, they will not show geometrical because of the arrangements will be equivalent. Matlab, they will have symmetry over there. So because of that, they will not be showing any type of geometrical isomerisms. Then isomerism with coordination number 6. Now with coordination number 6 over there, that's octahedral D2 SP3 or SP3 D2. We can have 2Cl on the same side. That's going to be nothing but the cis isomer. And 2Cl on the opposite side, that's going to be the trans isomer. That's the part what we see. And the geometrical isomer, we can also call it as cis or FAC. Is this clear? Where we say each 3 of the donor atoms of the similar ligands occupy adjacent position at the corners of the same face of the octahedron. Look at that. 3Cl occupying the adjacent positions of the triangular face. That way, then that is what we call as cis or FAC isomer. And the other is what we call as trans or the meridional isomer, where the position occupied are along the meridian of the octahedron. So meridian is basically like this, the 3Cl, that way. Then that's what we have as trans or the mer form. And complex of the type X2, Y2, Z2, they show cis and trans, where we say the 2 Z groups are in cis and trans position. They have cis one, and total we have 5 complexes possible, where the X, Y, and Z each can be with cis and trans with each other. That is one. Then complex of the type. Now AA means basically you are having a bidentate ligand or something over there, or AA2, that is basically 2 bidentate ligands, and they can show cis trans over there. And along with that, they will also show extra-levo. Whereas look at that, the 2Cl on the same side, then that is cis, 2Cl on the opposite side, then that is trans. And that Cl can have the 2 in groups. They will also show nothing but what we can call as optical. That is the next part to discuss. So complexes of the type AAX2Y2 can show geometrical cis and trans isomerism. Look at that. So here we can have the 2 ammonia. Is this clear? What you see on the same side, that will be cis, and the 2 ammonia on the opposite side, that will be trans there. That's one part. Octahedral complex of the type MABCD, which have all 6 different over there, they can exist in 15 different theoretical isomers, but then it's not possible to separate these isomers. Is this clear? That's the reason why generally we don't discuss the one with all monodentate, all 6 monodentate, it'll be difficult to isolate over there that way. So due to its isolation being difficult, you know, we just have a practical concept that is difficult, that, you know, we can have isomers, but difficult to separate them. The only complex prepared so far is this complex where we have all of them different over there. Then octahedral complex of the type MAB3, matlab you will have 3 tridentate unsymmetrical ligands, then that will show cis trans over there, as well as look at that part. So this is cis, they are on the same side, and here they are on the opposite sides. What we have, that is what we have as the trans isomer. That's one part. Then again, octahedral complex of MA6 or MEB5 will not show geometrical isomerism, because if you have all 6, not possible to locate it, or with A5 also not possible. Then optical isomers, what we call them as enantiomers or enantiomorphs, or we also call them as non-superimposable mirror images of each other, where dextro towards the right side, that's D or plus, levo L or minus. Then normally we say complexes with coordination number 4 and 6 having chelating ligands only will try to show this part over there. And when they are in the ratio of 1:1, we call that as a racemic mixture. We have discussed this in the organic part also. Racemic mixture, mixture containing equimolar amounts of dextro and levo varieties. Is this clear? In 1:1 ratio, that's a racemic mixture which is optically inactive. and that's due to external compensation. Externally, it will get cancelled. Now, isomerism with coordination number 4. Now, square planar do not show optical because these contain a plane of symmetry. Tetrahedral complexes, which contain unsymmetrical bidentate, they will try to show over there. So look at that. If you have this category, so this line important. Examples is given as an extra point. This line is there at the NCRT also. A tetrahedral complex, which contain unsymmetrical bidentate ligands, like MAB2 types, they will show optical activity. Normally, if they are monodentate, it will not show. But if you have this types, like BIS, that's basically a benzyl acetate ion. So that's called a benzoyl acetone A2 ion, beryllium 2. Both is going to have over there in forms of dextro and labo. Or if I have BIS glycine A2 with nickel, then that will have dextro as well as labo rotations towards the rotating on the right or rotating towards the left over there, depending how the rotations are. This is one. Then examples in complexes with coordination number 6. Now with 6, we have one bidentate and we have two monodentate each of X2, Y2. Or we have two bidentate and two monodentate. Two bidentate and XY, two separate monodentate. Then in that case, they can be resolved into a pair of enantiomers. They exist in cis and trans isomers. Trans does not show optical isomerism because it has a plane of symmetry. So total we have is 3 isomers. Some examples over there. This is the cis part. Is this clear? So here also cis with respect to the Cl or with respect to these two ammonia, you can say. That is one. Here the unidentate, that is the chloride ions and the ammonia groups should be cis-cis to each other. So both cases. So here either I'm talking with respect to, if you observe, either the 2Cl or the 2-ammonia, both are cis to each other. Same way there, the 2-ammonia or the 2Cl, both have to be cis to each other that way. Chloride ions should be cis-cis to each other. And that's the trans part what we have. That is the 2Cl atoms over there. That is one part. So trans is optically inactive. Then the cis part, what we have, and the trans part. Both are cis again over there. So cis dextro moving in a clockwise direction. And again cis, we can have levo moving in the. So we can have basically, if I have two bidentate ligands and two monodentate ligands, then I can have, with respect to the monodentate, I can have cis and trans. And with respect to the bidentate, either in clockwise or anticlockwise, I can have dextro and levo. That is one. Octahedral complex with 3 bidentate ligand will show optical isomerism. As look at that, 3 ene or 3 oxalato groups. Then we can have isomerism in such a way. This is dextro moving on the right or levo. Here also with the oxalato complex, dextro as well as levo. Then complex of the type, that is basically all monodentate types, 2 of each, X, Y, Z, all monodentate. Then that exhibits isomerism over there. So the geometrical isomer part over there, that is cis, 2 pyridine, 2 ammonia, or the 2Cl. All are basically what we can talk in terms of cis over there. Or we can have cis in this form also, changing the positions. So either of them, will be cis over there. That's one. Octahedral type containing hexadentate ligands such as EDTA or all 6 different can be resolved into a pair of enantiomers. That is one. Then we have the next category, the structural isomers. That is the different structures, arrangement of the ligands around the central atom. When structural, we will be talking about the 4 different types. One is linkage isomerism. Linkage is with respect to the ambidentate ligand, where you can have ONO and NO2. That way. So nitrito N, nitrito O. Isocyanate group or the cyanide group. SCN, that's basically a thiocyanato or isocyanato. That way we can have the groups. Some examples of linkage isomerism. Look at that. NO2 can be written as ONO, or SCN can be written as NCS. Second category is coordination isomerism, in which cation as well as anion complex and the ligands may interchange their position. So you can have exchange of ligands between two separate complexes to make sure the coordination number is maintained. So you can have here with ammonia 6 and oxalato 3. So one can be either changing the metals only, chromium with ammonia or cobalt with oxalato. Same way we can have look at that. Cobalt ammonia and chromium with cyanide, or here it can be chromium with ammonia or cobalt with cyanide, like that examples we can have. And we can keep interchanging the ligands also inside. That is one. Second is ionization, that is for the ions inside and outside what we see. So you have here bromide will be the ligand and sulfate is the ionizing part. Second one, sulfate is inside being the ligand and bromide is the ionizing part. That way we can talk. Then solvate or hydrate isomer. This is with respect to water inside and water outside. Okay. That is the water molecules. Look at that. H2O6Cl3, H2O5Cl, and one water is gone out that way. So out of the 3 Cl which were out, 1 Cl has come in and one water has gone out that way. Same way, look at the other one. Here we have CrH2O4. We can have 4 Cl in and 2 water going out. And out of the 3 Cl, 2 Cl coming in. So like that, examples can be put up. That's solvate or hydrate. Then coordination position isomerism. This is due to the polynuclear complex due to the interchange of ligands between the metal atoms. Like on this cobalt, you had ammonia and chlorine. All right. And here it was only ammonia. So what has happened with ammonia has become 3 and 1 Cl has come. And over here, 1 ammonia has shifted this side. So that is what we call as coordination position isomers. Then geometrical isomers differ in the properties such as the dipole moment part. So polymerization isomerism over there, having empirical formula similar, is this clear, but different molecular formula. Like for example, we can have PtNH3 twice Cl2 and PtNH3 4, is this clear, and PtCl4. So their molecular formulas will be same, but the structural formulas would be different over there. That's the polymerization isomerism. Ligand isomerism, the ligand itself is capable of showing isomerism depending upon where it is attached. Like here it is at position 1 and 2, here it is at position 1 and 3 over there. That way, these are all extra points what we have: polymerization isomerism, ligand isomerism. But just know from the content point, that's all. Valency isomerism, when the ligand is held by different types of valency bonds, sometimes primary or sometimes secondary. Like if you see carefully here, you have NH2 and a halogen is outside. Now one NH and HX has come here and halogen has gone outside as X3 directly over there. That is one part. So depending upon how they are being attached over there. Then one more extra point is there, that is the Waskas complex. That's the name given to transcarbonyl chlorido bis triphenyl phosphinium iridium 1. That's a compound that adsorbs. So just know the use of this compound. In case, very, very rare, but it's an extra point again. It readily absorbs oxygen and becomes orange colored. And the oxygen may be removed by flushing with nitrogen. So this reversible oxygenation, that's basically oxygen carrying ability of hemoglobin. That can be, you know, that can be understood by this complex. Then Werner's theory, that is the coordination sphere as well as the ionization sphere, that is a primary valence is going to be your oxidation state. Secondary valence is going to be your coordination sphere that way. So how many chloride inside, outside, that can be understood with the Werner's theory part. Well, look at this table carefully. COCl3 coordination complexes with 6 over there. So here you will have 6 ammonia. And so all 6 ammonia will be inside and Cl3 will be outside. So the electrolyte is 1:3. It will give 3 chloride ions. Total ions produces 4. Primary valence, matlab oxidation state of cobalt is +3. Secondary valence is going to form 6 coordinate bonds with the 6 monodentate ammonia ligands. That way. So you can predict over there. Same way COCl3.5 ammonia. So 5 ammonia and 1 Cl. So 2 Cl will be outside. So this will give you 2 chloride ions, or it will give you 2 moles of precipitate of AgCl with AgNO3. Then COCl3 with 4 ammonia. So 4 and 2 Cl will be inside. Only 1 Cl will be outside. Coordination number 6. And same way here, I will have these two are nothing but the different colors with respect to their isomers, what it forms. That is COCl3.4 ammonia will have two categories. Ions produced are two only over there, but the colors are going to be different over there because those are the isomers depending on their cis and trans that way. Where it says the last two have identical empirical formula, but different color due to different isomers, that is cis and trans. Then this part is all Werner's theory is fine. That like you have the primary valence, that's I said is the oxidation state. Secondary valence is nothing but its coordination number. How many coordinate bonds or how many dative bonds between the metal and the ligand. So both valencies, primary and all, primary, secondary valencies. Now drawbacks of Werner were what? Certain metals, elements possess the remarkable property of forming coordination compounds. The bonds in the coordination sphere have directional characteristics. That was not explained by Werner. Then they also have certain magnetic and optical properties. Werner's concept was only about primary and secondary valence. Magnetic properties came with respect to the VBD concept. Optical properties about its optical isomerism also was not explained by Werner. Then we have the VBT put up, where we say the metal ligand covalent bond is due to donation of lone pair from the ligand to the metal in its vacant orbitals. And it will utilize orbitals, that is penultimate n-1d and outermost shell ns. So depending upon how many bonds it forms, that would be its coordination number, and oxidation state of the metal is also developed depending upon how the arrangement is. So that is one part. So hybridization concept is what was given with respect to the VBT part. So when the approach of ligands, metal ligand bonds are formed by the overlap over there, we have different complexes, octahedral, D2SP3 or SP3D2, square planar DSP2, tetrahedral, that's SP3, trigonal bipyramidal, that will be SP3D or DSP3, square pyramidal, that's distorted SP3D2 or linear complexes, that's by SP hybridized. So here are a few of the examples to get an idea. Chromium, how does the whole thing, like CrNH3+? So chromium has to lose 3 electrons. Chromium is 4s1 3d5, argon 4s1 3d5. First electrons will go from 4s, so 4s may say 1 goes and 2 goes from the 3d. So it has got 3d3 configuration. So 3d3 is there. So in this case, when the ammonia is coming over there, all three will remain unpaired because it just needs 2 of the d orbital, which are anyway vacant. So in this case, it will not pair up. So this will be forming D2SP3 hybridized over there, how it goes. And it has got 3 unpaired electrons. So the complex is paramagnetic. All right. So with coordination number 6, remember in mind, you will have just 2 hybridized state, either D2SP3 or SP3D2. Then formation of complexes of some metal transition atoms. Now there's the whole table given over there with respect to the hybridized state, what it forms, and how many unpaired electron it has and wherever it pairs up. Pairing up is generally because of the strong field ligands like carbon monoxide, cyanide, ammonia, ethylene diamine, okay? Oxalato ions, all those are strong field ligands. Weak field ligands, that is water, then the halides, fluoride, chlorides, bromides, iodides, all those are going to be the weak field ligands over there. So there, they will always generally try to form a high spin complex. So with respect to the ligands part, in the next part, what we'll be seeing is the strong field ligands, that's the spectrochemical series. The strong field ligands will always try to form, pair up the electrons in the low energy level, utilize the orbitals of the low energy level. So they will form a low spin complex or an inner orbital complex, utilizing the orbitals of the inner shells. Weak field ligands will try to form a outer orbital complex, utilize the orbitals of high energy level, or they will form high spin complex. So that's the entire example part. What is there? The table is there. Yeah. Strong field ligands, So the strong field ligands will try to forcibly try to pair up, and they will utilize the lower orbitals. Within the lower orbitals, that is a dxy, yz, xz, and thus making dx square minus y square and z square vacant orbitals available for d2sp3 hybridization. Whereas for weak field ligands, that is the halides, water, etc., then in that case, it's unable to pair it up. So they will form the sp3d2 by the high spin complex. Inner and outer complexes, that's the same part. Complexes involving inner n-1d, that is d2sp3, they are called the inner orbital or hyperligated over their complexes. They are generally diamagnetic, not always, but sometimes they have reduced paramagnetism. Like for example, we saw up over here, the same example, this one, look at that. CrNH3+. Ammonia is a strong field ligand, but it doesn't pair up because the 2D orbitals are anyway available. So this will be basically showing paramagnetic behavior. So general trend is all the ones with D2SP3, they are going to be diamagnetic, but some do show reduced paramagnetism. They're also called low spin complexes. Complexes involve outer ND, that is the case of SP3D2. There's the weak field ligands, that's the outer orbital complexes or hypoligated complexes, and they are generally paramagnetic. And the magnetic properties you can measure, that is the spin magnetic moment only. Nu is root of N into N plus 2, where N is the number of unpaired electrons. Bm is the Bohr's magneton. Then, All right, what it says now is about the metal pairing. D123, that is in titanium 3+, vanadium, and this. They have two vacant D orbitals are always available for D2SP3. That's what we saw in chromium also. So their magnetic moments are found to be for 1, 2, or 3 unpaired electrons, whether it be weak field or strong field. So strong field normally, understand, with titanium, vanadium, and chromium, they will show paramagnetic behavior. That's to catch Ti3+, V3+, and Cr3+. For metal ions containing more than 3 unpaired electrons in the d orbital, 2 empty d orbitals can be made available if the 3d electron pairs up, like in D4, Mn3, D5, and D6. The magnetic moment data shows maximum spin pairing occurs in cases. With D6, there are complications with having D4 and, but there are some complications are there depending upon which metal atom is there. We can decide over there. Now here they have all zero magnetic, means they do have magnetic moments. Look at that. Complexes with strong field ligands, cyanide as well as oxalate, have magnetic moments corresponding to 2, 1, and 0. And they are the inner orbital complexes. So it's not that all strong field ligands will always form over their diamagnetic compounds. They may form over their paramagnetic also. That's reduced paramagnetism. Complexes with weak field ligands. Weak field, though, we know their magnetic moments are generally corresponding to 4, 5, and 4 unpaired electrons. That's the outer orbital complex, sp3d2. Predicting the geometry over there, it depends on the ligand, which orbitals it is using. So we can predict the geometry part, like NiCl4 2-. Magnetic moment is due to 2 unpaired electrons, which means in the complex, the ion utilizes 3D orbital, does not pair up. So the 3D does not pair up to accommodate 1. We will have, what will happen? The electron pair forms 4 ligands. That's in the sp3 shaped over there. That's the sp3 hybrid orbital, 1s n 3p. The shape is tetrahedral, but NiCn4-, nickel is in +2. Complex has no unpaired electrons because nickel is atomic number 28, 4s2, 3d8. +2 goes because it's in +2 state, so 2 electrons from 4s. 3d8, D subshell is made up of 5 orbitals. Cyanide will pair up all the 8. So it will be dsp2. So it will be square planar geometry. So depending on the ligands and the metal, we can predict its which hybridized state or what would be the shape of the orbital depending on its hybridization. Drawbacks over there, there is no interpretation of the magnetic data or kinetic stability of the complex. Stability of the complex, we don't have any idea. Doesn't explain the spectral properties, okay, which will be colored, which will be deeply colored and all, or which will be colorless. does not make the exact prediction regarding the tetrahedral and square planar of 4. And 4b is, you know, maybe dsp2 or sp3. Does not distinguish between strong and field, that is the spectrochemical series. Does not explain why complexes in a particular oxidation state are inner orbital, while in some cases they are outer orbital. Based on that, we have the CFT to talk over there. Now, with respect to, more points are there. Could not explain why excitation occurs in one square planar complex, but not in the other, giving paramagnetic. We just now saw, no? For the chromium complex top. Okay, there the pairing is not happening because it has the 2D orbitals. But if I'm using some other complex, like for FeCN4 2 minus, where Fe is in over there, nothing but FeCN6 4 minus, where Fe is in plus 2, they're all gets paired up. So why it gets paired up? Or FeCN6 3 minus, one electron remains unpaired only over there. So what is the logic there? The part, okay, some places the D orbitals are available, some places it is not available. Cupra ammonium complex, it couldn't explain because here, if you remember, it's an exception one, an important part. One of the 3D electron jumps to the 4D orbital. How does that happen? That part is not there. So CFT is there, where it says very important, the interaction between the metal and the ligand, they are basically point charges. They are mainly electrostatic attraction. That's what CFT says. The bonds are 100% ionic. The D orbitals are all degenerate in the absence of any ligand coming. Degenerate means all are of equal energy. But when the ligand comes, then it splits up the d substrate or the d orbitals into different parts, lower and high energy level. The degeneracy is mentioned. However, when this negative field is due to the real ligands in the complex, the degeneracy is lifted due to the asymmetrical field. This splitting is upon the nature of the crystal field, such as octahedral, tetrahedral, square planar, or basic strength of ligands. First part, CFT, with respect to octahedral. So in octahedral, the arrangement goes this way. Please have a look at it. The D orbitals in the free ion, all are degenerate orbitals. Then average energy of the D orbital in a spherical crystal field. Then they split up into lower and higher. That is del naught, what we have, where one del naught is 10 dequeril. So there we have three of lower energy level in octahedral, that is called the T2G orbitals. And two of high energy levels, that's the EG orbitals, dx square minus y square and z square. So when the electrons, so the dxy, yz and xz are the ones of low energy. So if it's a strong field ligand, it will pair up the lower ones and then it will enter into the higher ones. So there the energy is lowered by minus 0.4 del naught. That is 2 out of 5, because two orbitals are of high energy level out of 5. That's why it's lowered by minus 4. And above it is nothing but plus 0.6, 0.6, 3 by 5. 3 are lowered out of 5. Is this clear? And 2 are the ones which are raised. So 3 by 5 del naught is what the energy is raised by. That is the part. So you can calculate the what we call as the CFSE, crystal field stabilization energy, which is, if you have to put it up over there, it is with respect to this formula. That is minus 0.4 into x. Plus 0.6 into y, 0.4 into x. X will be the electrons in the T2g orbital, and plus 0.6 y. Y will be the electrons in the EG orbitals. That way. And CFSC value, if it is lower than or negative, then the complex is more stable. The difference is basically the splitting over there, where we say these are of less energy as compared to this. The d orbitals of metal into two sets. Yeah. That's the T2G and the EG orbitals. The crystal field energy difference of T2G and EG is measured in terms of the parameters del naught, where O corresponds to octahedral, and DQ, that's dequeril part. The magnitude of splitting is fixed at 10 dequeril. That's the part. So we have the energy difference over there. Then the spectrochemical series, they arrange in the increasing order of their strength, ability to cause crystal field splitting. So the ones which can allow it to split. So iodide is the least. That's what I said. The halides are down over there. Look at that carefully. And here are all the strong ones. So you have, so here in this category, if you see, look at that. Carbon monoxide, cyanide over there. Then we have ammonia. So water is weak here. If I talk about oxalato, Is this clear? That's nothing but ox. And oxalato is up, but still it's a strong field because it's a chelating ligand. That's why oxalato is a strong field ligands. Ligands arranged left to ammonia are generally regarded as weak field ligands. That way, what it says. So they are the ones which will not allow more of splitting there, which cannot cause forcibly pairing of electrons within 3D. Ammonia and all ligands riding on the right side, they are the strong field ligands. They form the inner orbital complex there. So that's the spectrochemical series. This order needs to be memorized because you can have a question on this one. When calculation of CFSE, what we have the formula, that's what I said, minus 0.4x plus 0.6y del naught. That's the part. Answer with a negative sign indicates the stability of the splitting. Okay. Then we have the three parts. If the del naught is greater than P, then it's a strong field ligand. It forms a low spin complex. And if del naught is less than P, then it will be a high spin complex. So look at that part, what it says. If del naught is greater than P, strong field ligand, low spin complex. Pairing will happen in the T2G with EG remaining unoccupied. So the answer when you calculate with CFSE will be negative. Okay, I've given the table down. Similarly, if I have this type of a complex, titanium is in plus one. So it's only going to be in the T2G. So CFSE is minus 0.4 del naught only. Same way, vanadium 3 plus, chromium 3 plus, they will just have 2 or 3 unpaired electrons. So that's how here it will be 0.4 into 2, nothing in the EG. And same way for chromium 3. So first 3 will all will go in the parallel in the T2G. So it will be minus 1.2 del naught. So lower the value on the negative side, more is the stability. All right. D4 to D7, we can have different probabilities, right? The fourth electron is favorable. So that's what it says. It may occupy lower, but becomes paired. So depending upon the ligand part. So the second point, if del naught is less than P, then in that case, we will say P is the pairing energy. Then it's going to form a weak field ligand or a high spin complex. Then it will try to occupy electrons in the EG orbital that way. So look at this table. This table explains everything. For D4, you can have two probabilities there, high spin and low spin. So in D4, first T2G, 1, 2, 3, and the fourth one goes here. So if you put your CFSE, your answer comes as minus 0.6 del naught. But if it is a, this is basically with a weak field ligand, it will not pair up. That's why the word weak field. And here the strong field, may what will happen? It will pair up. So 1, 2, 3, first all three parallel as per Hund's rule, and the fourth one comes here. So all are in the T2G only. So the answer is minus 1.6 del naught plus the pairing energy that way. Then over here, why 1P? Because two electrons have got paired, na? So that's the pairing energy P. So that's why it just says plus P. That's only for one, what I've circled. Look at the second one with D5. For weak field, 3 will go and 2 will go up. So its answer is 0 basically. And here how the 5 will go? First 3 parallel, 2 anti-parallel. So here if you work out, it's going to be all are in the T2G only. So it's minus 2 del naught plus 2 times P because 2 orbitals have got paired. So plus 2P. Same way D6. 3, 4, 5 and the 6th one is here. Come in the T2G. That way. So that's nothing but minus 0.4 del naught. And in the strong field, all 6 will pair up in the T2G only. So there it is minus 0.24 del naught plus 3P because 3 orbitals have got paired. And finally D7. D7 in weak field. First 3, 4, 5. That's my 6th electron. That's my 7th electron. That's how it goes. So 3 and 2, 5 up and then 2 down. So here it's minus 0.8 del naught and 2P because 2 orbitals have only got paired. Whereas over here, if you observe, how will the, for strong field, how will the complex be? All 3 down and again, 3 will come in the opposite spin. So first 3 in the parallel, 3 in the anti-parallel and then this is my 7th one. So that's minus 1.8 del naught plus 3P because 3 orbitals have got paired. So CFSE, if they're asking you, it's basically this table. Okay. So that's one point. Then Then CFSE other systems, D1, 2, 3 is going to be direct, and 8, 9, 10, the number of unpaired electrons are fixed. So there is only one possible way in which D orbitals can be filled over there. So look at that, CFSC for 8, 9, and 10, if you observe. 8, 9, and 10, the values are going to be over there. It's fixed only, what's going to be. So here you will have D8, T2G6, EG2. That's how you get it. All right. And same way, T2G, then D9. So you will have T2G6, EG3. That's the part. And last one, D10, that's going to be T2G6, EG4. That's going to be zero over there. So here applications wise, we can talk about high spin and low spin complexes. What we have, D1 to 3 and D8 to 10. Is this clear? There is only one possible way in which the D orbital fills. Hence, they exist in the same state of minimum energy, irrespective of the field. You have changes only from D4 to D7, depending upon strong field and weak field ligands. Strong field ligands, low spin complex. Weak field ligands, high spin complex. Magnetic behavior, strong field ligands generally will try to pair up, but not always. So generally, with strong field ligands, complexes are diamagnetic, but not always. Some of them do show reduced paramagnetic behavior also. And normally the weak field ligands, they generally form high spin complex or they are paramagnetic over there. All right, because their probability to pairing is less. That's one. Color of the complex people we can find depending upon, first of all, color depends upon what property. Color depends on the number of presence of unpaired electron. If there are no unpaired electron, then the complex will not show any color. It will be colorless. But if there's an unpaired electron, then when light falls, the d orbital will split into lower and high energy levels. And you can have over there nothing but from the visible light, that is 400 to 800 nanometers, a particular wavelength of the white light is absorbed and the electron jumps from lower d orbital to higher d orbital. That is dd transition. Now, depending upon the wavelength of the light absorbed, the remaining wavelengths are reflected back on the compound. So the color what we see on the compound is a complementary color, or the remaining wavelengths which are reflected back on the compound. Like the complex TiH2O6+, it appears to be purple in color because it has absorbed the green portions of the white light. So the remaining wavelengths, when they are reflected back, the complementary color is the purple color. So that's part. So that's the color of the complex part. So color of the complex, what it says, the crystal field for most is the same order of the magnitude of the energy of photon. Therefore, the possible, yeah. So there's the same formula, people, what we have, hc by lambda is equal to no, that's Avogadro's number, is it clear, into h nu. H nu, nu is equal to c by lambda. So that's Avogadro's number into h into c by lambda. So if you calculate the energy part, that's the energy per mole. That's why I've taken Avogadro's number over there. So here we say, therefore, greater the value of del naught, it is sufficient to excite the electrons from T2G to EG. In this case, the green and yellow portions are absorbed and the complex acquires purple color, which is the complementary color. Similarly, CuH2O4+ is blue in color because the red light corresponding to 6,000 angstrom units, or you can say 600 nanometers, is absorbed over there. Same with the cobalt complexes. The crystal field of the ligands is in this order, spectrochemical series, and the coordination entities also will be in the same order. So the wavelength will be in the opposite order because energy and lambda are inversely proportional. So the complementary colors will be transmitted as shown in the table below there, that way. Okay. As the color of the complex changes with the concentration of the ligand, look at that. H2O6 complex obtained by dissolving nickel chloride in water and add more amount of didentate ligand, the following change takes place. So look at that. Normally it's green with water, which is a weak ligand, but when you add ene, the color changes to pale blue because the complex becomes more stable. Same way. So that is one part. Same way here, water and ene, that's pale blue. If you add more ene, it becomes bluish purple. And further, if you add ene, it changes to violet over there, because the complex is attaining more stability with respect to the chelating ligand. It is important to note that in the absence of ligand, CFT does not happen, and hence the substance is colorless. Look at that. TiH2O6Cl3 is purple, but anhydrous TiCl3 is colorless. Copper sulfate is blue in color, but anhydrous copper sulfate is colorless. So it's mainly the ligand which causes the electron splitting over there, either to pair up or to make it unpaired over there. And hence the color is because of the ligand which is present, which will either allow it to keep it. If all are paired up, no unpaired electron, then it's going to be colorless. Or if there are unpaired electrons, we will have the complementary colors on the compound. Then what it says, now these are the little bit extra parts what we have. DD transition is governed by the following rules. Matlab, on what basis you have the DD part over there? Again, an extra part this is. One is nothing but the Laporte orbital selection. Transitions in which involves a change in the subsidy quantum number, that is LS plus and minus one, is this clear, are basically Laporte allowed, and therefore they have a high absorbance. But DD transitions are forbidden since the change in L is zero. So we don't have it because the L does not change. L will, because since L, you don't have a L changing over there. L is with respect to your azimuthal magnetic number. That's going to remain the same over there. So that's one. Second is the spin selection formula. Spin selection formula during transition, electron does not change its spin as delta S is zero. Delta S change in entropy is zero. So in weak field ligands, the DD transitions are spin forbidden because each of the D orbital is single occupied. Many Mn2 compounds are mainly off-white or pale flesh colored, but the intensity is only 1/100 of the spin allowed transitions. So these are the extra points to get an idea what leads to the DD transition. Same way we have the John Taylor distortion over there. Octahedral complexes, six ligands split into T2G and EG. Corresponding repulsion between the D electrons and the ligand. So if the D electrons are D electrons of the metal are symmetrically arranged, that's T2G6EG2, T2G6EG4, and EG0. They will repel all six ligands equally. Thus, the structure will be regularly an octahedral. And if the D electrons are asymmetric, like T2G3, then OEG1, T2G6EG1, T2G5EG2, and T2G6EG3, they will repel some ligands over there. Therefore, the structure is distorted. Now, this is just an extra add-on part for DD transition. Now, CFT with respect to tetrahedral coordination, it's exactly the opposite of what we call as octahedral. So here, if you see, the orbitals are exactly opposite. Del T, now the G is removed over there. All right. So we have it just as E orbitals and the T2 orbitals. So D orbitals all degenerate first. Then the average energy when the ligand is approaching and they split up. So lower ones now, what was T2G? Lower. Here the T2G, G is removed. So T2 becomes higher and the E becomes lower. So here it's lowered by minus 0.6 del naught. That is basically what we have as 3/5 because 3 are up. And here it's increased by 0.4 del. Is that clear? Just exactly opposite with respect to the octahedral part. That is one, what we see. Then next point, what we have is the difference. Yeah. So the difference del T is 4/9 del naught. That's the part. So if you compare the CFT of both, 4 sp3, 1 s3p, and 9, 4 of the sp3, 5 of the what we call as nothing but the what I can call 9 will be the total part what we have. That is the 5d orbitals. We have 5d, no? So 5 of the d orbitals and 4 of the tetrahedral. That way. So total 4+5, 9. So 4/9 del naught. Smaller the value of delta T as compared to del naught is partly because only 4 ligands produce a weak field ligand. So the configuration D1, D2, D7, 8, 9, and 10 shall exist only in one state in tetrahedral. So again, D3, D4, and D4, D5, and D6 both have high spin and low spin. Since the magnitude of delta T is quite small, it's always less than the pairing energy. Hence, only high spin tetrahedral complexes are formed. In fact, no tetrahedral complex with low spin is known to exist because tetrahedral may always try to occupy the inner orbitals of high energy. Difference between octahedral, tetragonal distorted octahedral, and square planar complexes. Now here, in this category, see, we can have octahedral, that is six on the plane, up and down, that's octahedral. Then we have tetragonally distorted. Now, tetragonally distorted, when you're talking, then look at that four. The four ligands is basically in the arrangement of L1, 2, 3, 4, they lie on the plane, 5 and 6 over there. The logic of distorted will be what over there? ML6 when we are talking. Normalis here, here one of them would be the L, would be nothing but the ligand. But in the ligand, you will have over there nothing but the ligands in the transposition over there. That's what it says. Look at that. In octahedral complex A, all six ligands lie at equal distance. So when two trans ligands along the Z-axis are not completely removed, but are at large distances compared to the four ligands in the XY plane. And that's called a tetragonally distorted octahedral structure, that is structure B. So the ligands are going to experience more repulsion. That's what it says. So along the Z-axis, I'm reading this part again, see here. When two trans ligands along the Z-axis are not completely removed, but are at a larger distance, L5 and L6, okay? Then such is called a tetragonally distorted structure. And then it says quaplanar geometry C can be derived from octahedral by complete removal of two trans ligand along the Z axis. If you remove the two, then we have only the square planar octahedral. So three types of octahedral: normal octahedral, tetragonally distorted octahedral, and square planar octahedral. If you remove the two ligands up and down, then CFT in tetragonally distorted part. Yes, this is what we discussed over there. In tetragonally distorted and octahedral. Now, this is an extra part. We just have two complexes to talk. That's octahedral and tetrahedral. So this part is just given over here with respect to the advanced part. So my suggestion would be this part. You can just leave this part, because here we are going to talk about tetragonally distorted octahedral. So this entire three things what we have. We just have the regular octahedral and the tetrahedral part. These are the extra part what we have of octahedral, tetragonally distorted, and the square planar part. So this part is fair enough. Limitations, what we have with respect to the CFT. Yes, then those are the ones which are covered by the MOT, molecular orbital theory. Formation of structures, magnetic behavior. The CFT is successful, but it fails to explain the position of the anionic ligand at the low end of the spectrochemical series. OH ions, which lies below water and ammonia in the series, produces a greater splitting. Why that was not explained? Metal ligand bonds are basically, it says it's ionic. So it doesn't account for the covalent character, where VBD says they are coordinate covalent. And those weaknesses are covered with respect to the MOT part. Factors affecting the magnitude, one is the oxidation state. Higher the ionic charge on the central atom, greater is the value of del naught. This you mark important, no? In case some theoretical questions are coming. Nature of metal ion. The del values of complexes formed by metals belonging to 3D, 4D, 5D. As you go, going from 3D to 4D, the del value increases by approximately 50%. So the complexes having 4D and 5D transition have greater tendency to form low spin. So the more you go deep inside the orbitals, that is 3D, 4D, 5D over there, then in that case, it forms a stable complex. That's one point. Then comes the geometry. Del T values, that is tetrahedral values, only 50% as large as compared to del naught. This suggests a low del value of tetrahedral geometry to the complex. Majority complexes, what we see are octahedral. That's why it says over there, del T values is only 50% as large as of del naught. Nature of ligands, that with respect to the spectrochemical series, which will cause greater splitting there. CFT for complexes, yeah, that is the part. Then color of gemstones, yes, this is an important point. Again, from a theoretical part, in case if they're asking you. Ruby, that's a mineral corundum that contains alumina. Here, they will not ask percentages which ions it contains. So it contains alumina, and the chromium ions are randomly distributed in place of aluminium ions. So that's one ruby. So it has an octahedral complex, that's the part. Then topaz, that's a mineral corundum containing ferric ions, also called yellow sapphire. Then amethyst, that's basically the deep purple color containing manganese ions. So all these are basically the gemstones or the colored stones what we get. All the other coordinated complex. Emerald, That's of the mineral beryl containing chromium ions along the octahedral sides. So here just know these, no need to transitions and all are given, but mainly if they're asking you, then these are also the coordinated part. Now, greater stability of CO3 plus complex than CO2 plus complex. It's mainly because of the CFSC part. CO3 plus definitely will be more, charge by radius ratio is greater, is less stable as oxidized over there. This is because of the CO3 plus, it's D6. So it's T2G6 EG0. So all will get paired up. And CO2 plus is D7. So one has to go in the EG. So that's why CO3 plus will be more stable than CO2 plus. And second, we do look at also with respect to the charge by size ratio. EAN is effective atomic number, where we have the formula. EAN is equal to Z minus X plus Y. Z, atomic number of the central atom. X is its oxidation state. And Y, number of electrons forming coordinate bonds that way. Okay, so if I have five coordinate bonds, then the number of electrons are 10 that way. So EN has to come towards the nearest inert gas. So EN is defined as the total number of electrons of the metal or ion after the complex formation, which should be equal to that of the next higher noble gas for a stable complex. So the value is exactly coming to the configuration of inert gases. The complex is said to be more stable. That's one. Okay. A stable complex if the EN equals to the atomic number. EN is mainly applicable to metal carbonyls. That's one. Then comes the second last feature, the stability of coordination compounds. That is with respect to the stability constant, where we say greater the stability constant, more stable would be the ions over there. That's the part. So what it says, measure of the resistance of the replacement of ion by some other ligand. Matlab, the ligands cannot be replaced. That's the stability part. As a dissociation involves an equilibrium between the dissociated components and the undissociated complex, stability can be expressed in terms of an equilibrium constant called the dissociation equilibrium, called the stability constant. Whereas look at that. We have cupric ammonium ions giving you cupric ions and ammonia ions. Then cupric product, active mass of products upon active mass of reactants that we take. Then we say, if we take the information of the complex ion in the solution, copper plus ammonia gives the equilibrium constant called the stability constant beta. Can be written as what? Cupra ammonium ion upon cupric, products upon reactants. Is this clear? So stability constant is the reciprocal of instability constant. That is beta is 1 by k. That's what is done here. Look at that. This is the instability constant where the complex is getting ionized. So if it gets ionized, matlab, you can replace the ligand. Then the complex is less stable. If it does not dissociate, means the complex is more stable. That way. Greater the magnitude of stability constant, more stable is the complex. The stability of a coordination compound is the measure of the stability constant denoted as beta. So if you have more than one equilibrium happening, and how we have done an ion equilibrium, H2SO4 ionizes in two parts. H2SO4 first gives H plus plus HSO4 minus, and then HSO4 minus gives you H plus plus sulfate. So it ionizes in two steps. So the final K will be K1 into K2. K1 was H2SO4 giving H plus plus HSO4 minus, and K2 was HSO4 minus giving you further H plus and sulfate ions. So that's what it says. Whatever are the constants, you finally multiply all of them. So the product of all the constants will give you the net stability constants there. That is one. Greater the stability constant, stronger is the metal ligand bond, and greater is the stability of the complex there. That's the part. Yeah. So as more amine groups are added, the stability constant decreases. Log in the exam. Yeah, they have just put the log values to calculate how much is the entire part coming there. Yeah. Value of log beta is a measure of the stability of the complex. That is one. So that's what it says. Cupra ammonium ion has a greater log value than cadmium ammonium ion complex. That's the reason why we say that. That's why in group two, both precipitate in group two, cadmium as well as copper. So when H2S is passed, what it says, the complex will not give any precipitate, but the cadmium ions will form to give a precipitate. This was an MCQ also, which is there if you're solving in the fingertips, they have asked a question on this part. Okay, why will the cadmium precipitate and why not the cupric ions, because both belong to group 2 only, so they should precipitate, but then depends on the stability constant value. Stability constant is greater, so the cupric ions will not ionize, whereas second case with cadmium, the stability constant value is lower, so it will precipitate. Factors affecting the stability: charge on the central atom, greater the charge, greater the stability, greater the charge by radius ratio. What it says, the complex with trivalent central metal are more stable than divalent. That is given by a rule. We have a stability order of the 3D series called the Irving-William order, which basically goes from left to right. So if you see manganese, iron, cobalt, nickel, cupric, zinc, that's the order. So across a period from left to right, size will decrease. So the charges are same, but the size is smaller. So if the charges are same and the size is smaller, charge by radius ratio will be more. So if the charge by radius ratio is more, that's the Irving-William formula there. Nature of metal ion, they're grouped into two classes. Group 1, 2 in a transition series, and transition metals belonging to group 3 to 6. We have total 4 series, right? 3D, 4D, 5D, 6D, that way. Classified as acceptors, they form most stable coordination with ligands of nitrogen, oxygen, and fluorine. So metal ions of group 1, 2, inner transition elements and transition belonging to group 3 to 6, they are the ones which will form. Metal transition elements, that is rhodium, silver, iridium, gold, and mercury, these are basically the ones of group 11 there. They are full d orbitals and they are classified as b acceptors. They form stable complexes with donor atoms and heavier members of nitrogen, oxygen, fluorine groups. Then what it says more there. Next, basic nature of ligand. Greater the basic strength, matlab greater the power to donate lone pair of electrons, greater is the stability. Presence of chelating rings. Yes, if more are the number of chelating rings, then that's called the chelate effect, which is maximum for 5 or 6 membered rings. If it is a multidentate, a cyclic compound, then sometimes what it says, a further increase in stability occurs due to the macrocyclic effect provided. There are no steric effects. Steric means there should not be any electron-electron or nucleus-nucleus repulsion which will block the path. So if you have multidentate and it's a cyclic structure and repulsion is minimized, then it will be more stable there. The macrocyclic effect, what it says, it is the increased thermodynamic stability with the cyclic. This is all an extra part again. Okay. So this is the one, increased thermodynamic stability, which is attached to us non-cyclic ligand over there. So this is more stable over there with this type of ligand, cyclic ligands. That is one. Then preparation of coordination means how are these ligands formed? One is by direct combination of reactant. Nickel chloride with ammonia will form this complex. Or platinum chloride with ethylene diamine, 2 moles will form the complex. Substitution rings, stronger ligands replace the weaker ligand. So water is weak. When you react with ammonia, it replaces it. Or redox reactions, what happens? Metal atom in higher oxidation state is obtained by carrying the process of complex in the presence of an oxidizing agents like H2O2 or perchlorates. So where you can have a stable complex. And one important point, this was a question I had asked in one of the papers, the trans effect, substituting the second ligand, then the order is there. This you mark important. Effect of coordinated ligand already present on the rate of substitution of the second ligand at the position trans to itself in a square planar or octahedral complex is called the trans effect. It's a kinetic phenomenon. So already one ligand is present. So if there's a second ligand in the trans position with respect to the first, then that substitution is called as trans effect. And there the order is. This order is important. Okay. By carbon monoxide, cyanide, ethylene, diamine. These are the ones. C2H4 is ethylene. Sorry, not ethylene, diamine, just ethylene. And with respect to them, the second groups are substituted faster. Just know 3 or 4 of them. A phenyl group over here. That's it. Yeah. Then organometallic compounds having a carbon metal bond. So whenever you have, is this clear over there? These are compounds in which the metal is directly linked to carbon. Then that's what we call as a carbon metal bond directly. MC bond exists. Now the types of organic compounds, organometallic, sigma bonded, matlab they are bonded by sigma bonds. One example, we know Grignard's reagent RMgX, or we have over there, look at that, diethyl zinc, or we have tetraethyl tin. All these compounds, how they are formed, all are by sigma bonds. That's it. A polymeric chain also compounds is being formed over there. That is one part. Then we have pi bonded. Now pi bonded, when we are talking, the pi bonded complexes are with respect to where it forms pi bonds over there. They are transition normal sigma bonds formed by pi clouds of the organic molecule. Like we have Zeiss salt. This also is an extra part, again informative. You can have sigma as well as pi. Like platinum, potassium, platinum, chlorine. Then that formula is eta, eta square ethylene. Matlab you are having the two ethylene groups over there that way, the pi complexes. Then ferrocene. Ferrocene has got Fe with eta 5, that is C5H5. Now C5H5 groups two times that it forms. And dibenzene chromium, that is chromium eta 6. So C6H6, matlab basically where it says eta square shows the number of carbon bonded to the metal atoms. So carbon bonded eta square, matlab two bonds will be formed that way. So with the two ethylene groups, na, C2H4. So both the carbon will get added. Eta 5. So here you'll have the five carbon forming five bonds that way. Then eta 6, C6. So it'll form six bonds that way. This is just for informative. You can have pi bonded complex also. Normally in the NCERT part, we can have sigma and pi that way. Where normally we talk about the metal carbonyl compounds that we have. Then sigma and pi bonded through metal carbonyls. Yes. Now in all metal carbonyls, carbon monoxide, strong field ligand, oxidation state, all these are homoleptics, homoleptic complexes. That is nothing but you will have only carbon monoxide as the ligand over there. Metal oxidation state is zero. And if you remember, I've discussed with you, if you have to calculate the EAN, is this clear? Then EAN may for the common MN-MN bond, like in this category, you will take it as one. So here, if I have to do your EAN, Z, manganese 25, oxidation state zero, minus Z minus X plus Y. Sorry. So this will be 25 minus zero plus how many carbon monoxide? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. That's going to five bonds. So each made up of two. So total electrons 10 plus one. One is for the MN-MN bond. So 25 plus 10, 35 plus one, 36. That's the inert gas configuration of krypton. So the complex is stable. So whenever you have a direct bond, you take in the EN formula, you add one for it. So metal atom is always zero. All right. And it forms different complexes. NiCO4 is tetrahedral. FeCO5 is trigonal bipyramidal. That is DSP3 hybridized. That's the part. Then octahedral, that is decacarbonyl dimanganese, zero. Then we have CO2CO8, octacarbonyl dicobalt, zero. That's the part. Then Fe2FeO9, these are all extra parts what we have, how the ring complexes are formed. This is just informative. Then next part, the bonding over there. Yes. Now in the bonding part, very important, it forms sigma as well as pi bonds. I've given first to you over there, carbon monoxide, very, very important. The MOT of carbon monoxide, that's what we write as KK is sigma 1s2, sigma asterisk 1s2, then sigma 2s2, pi 2px2, pi 2py2, and sigma 2pz2. All right, that is one. Now in this category, if you observe, you have over there nothing but your sigma asterisk 2p, yeah, that already is the one which comes before only. Now the anti-bonding, these orbitals are vacant. Pi asterisk 2px0, pi asterisk 2py0, and pi asterisk 2pz0. These three anti-bonding are vacant. So when carbon monoxide combines with the metal, metal ka vacant orbitals in which carbon monoxide donates the lone pair. That's the metal ligand bond form, that is sigma. Pi bond is between the filled d orbitals of the metal, those electrons. they are donated into the vacant anti-bonding orbitals of carbon monoxide. So understand carefully, what is the metal carbon sigma bond donation of lone pair from the ligand to the vacant orbital of metal? That's a sigma bond, coordinate covalent bond. What is pi bond or the back bonding donation of electrons from the filled orbitals of from the filled orbitals of the metal into the vacant anti-bonding orbitals of carbon monoxide? That's called back bonding, which is a pi bond. So that's the part what we have. Now look at that. Carbon monoxide ligand binds to the metal, all right, and forms a weak sigma bond by donating a lone pair from the bonding. That's basically what we call as HOMO. We have done this part in the nature of chemical bond. Highest occupied molecular orbital of carbon monoxide to the empty d orbital of the metal. That is, this is the MCO bond form. That is a metal carbon bond form. CO acts as a acceptor ligand and forms a stronger pi bond over there. Also called the dative pi bond to the metal by accepting electrons from the filled d orbitals having pi symmetry, say dxy, to the lowest occupied molecular orbital, LUMO, that is the anti-bonding. See, bonding orbitals are of higher energy, that's why it's called HOMO, higher occupied, highest occupied molecular orbital, and LUMO, lowest occupied, is the anti-bonding. That's the part what we have. That is basically MCO. So now the metal is giving its filled electrons to the anti-bonding orbital. This characteristic property of back bonding is clear. This is called a synergic effect over there, and that strengthens the MCO bond. So the total bonding in MCO is like this, what we have. The bond order is reduced from triple to a double bond there, because normally MCO pairs between C and O, there is a triple bond, and it may increase. This is supported by the fact that the CO bond length in C double bond O is this much, and it increases to 115 picometers in many metal carbonyl because it possesses both sigma and pi bond. So please have a look at the diagram carefully. Sigma is carbon monoxide donating its lone pair into the vacant orbital. And the back bonding is metal ka filled electrons, the filled orbitals, donating the electrons in the anti-bonding orbitals. That's back bonding. That makes the MCO bond stronger there. Uses of metal carbonyls now. Now, what is this part over there? They are toxic, volatile, colorless. All this part is okay. They are highly reactive. Ligands such as we can form. Come in again, the strength of the sigma bond. Now, the strength of the sigma bond can be in this order with respect to the carbon monoxide ligand over there. Cyanide, isocyanide, carbon monoxide, and a NO+. That is a nitrosonium ion. Then, now these are extra compounds over there. Synthesis of organic compounds. Now this also is an entire extra part. We don't have that part. How they are formed. RMGX, so we know. RX plus MG, formation of Grignard's reagent in presence of diethyl ether. This compound is diethyl ether. Then same way, tetraalkyl and tetraalkyl lead and all. If you remember, we have discussed now tetraethyl lead, tetramethyl lead. They are the ones which are the anti-knock agents added to petrol. We don't have this part. This part is entirely extra. Preparation of Z salt, ferrocene, all this is extra. Metal carbonyls, just yes, these two important, what we have, how they form. That's it. Last part comes, the applications. Estimation of hardness of water, there we use EDTA, ethylene diamine, tetraacetate ions, charge of 4-. Animal chlorophyll, that's a coordinated complex of magnesium. Hemoglobin is of ferrous, Fe2+. Vitamin B12, that is of cobalt in 3+. So know these in case if they are putting you. Okay, which ions correspond to what? Yeah. Then carboxy peptidase, that is an enzyme, is a complex of zinc. And electroplating, use of the complex of the electrolyte in used of in is used in silver. Then we have potassium dicyanidoorate. Roman number 1, that's used in gold plating. Extraction of metals, that is the MacArthur Forest cyanide process. Gold and silver are extracted by dissolving in NaCl to form complex, and then you add zinc to it, metal displacement. Zinc will displace gold and silver from their complexes, and they will be precipitated out, and zinc will form its complex. Detection of ions, nickel ions by dimethyl glyoxime, that is one. Then ferric ions, that is basically where the ferrous and ferrous ions are generally converted to ferric, where it forms ferriferrocyanide, that is a Prussian blue color, what we have done in the qualitative analysis part. That was a test for ferrous ions. All right. Okay, ferrous ions, if they are present, then that with K3FeCN6, that will give you a Prussian blue color. And then you boil the solution with nitric acid to convert the ferrous to ferric and detect in group 3 of the cation analysis chart. Ferrous ions gives with Turnbull's blue color with potassium ferricyanide. So it's basically ferroferricyanide. That's what we have, the complex what it forms. Similarly, sulfide ions, that's detected with nitroprusside over there. That is one part, anion sulfide. Then purification of metals. Yeah. Decomposition. Nickel is converted to NiCO4, which is then broken down and it gives nickel in the pure form. This is basically what we call as Mohn's process. We'll be doing it in metallurgy. Then using chelate therapy in medicines. Cisplatin that we have discussed, that's basically used for treatment of cancer. That's diamine, dichlorido, platinum 2. Then we have lead poisoning is treated with EDTA. Excess of copper and iron is removed in the complex with D-penicillamine and D-ferroxoxime, that is by using chelating ligands. Then homogeneous catalyst, yes, Wilkinson's catalyst, that is their hydrogenation of alkenes. This is the compound, what we have. Rhodium over there. So that's chlorido, tris. We have triphenylphosphine, rhodium 1. Rhodium oxidation state is plus 1 and is DSP2 hybridized. That's important. Heterogeneous catalyst, Ziegler-Natta catalyst. As I have told you, polymerization of olefins, that is high density polythene is used, Ziegler-Natta catalyst. That's a combination of triethyl aluminium and titanium tetrachloride. Then organolithium and organomagnesium compound. Then this is the same thing, tetraethyl lead. That's basically anti-knock that is added to petrol to prevent the knocking of engine. Then photography we use over there, nothing, but it says the developed film is fixed with washing with hypo solution. Hypo is sodium thiosulf. So just specify over there, what is the hypo solution? Hypo solution is sodium thiosulfate solution, which dissolves by undecomposed silver bromide and also basically used as dyes or pigments. All right. Okay.